Before we get started with today's episode, Talk Music Talk has its very own app. That's right, and it's free for iPhone and Android. When you download the app, you get every single episode. You get the back catalog. You get new shows appearing in your feed automatically. You can download shows also, so you can listen to them offline. Star your favorite episodes. You can also share episodes on social media or email them directly right from the app. The app is available in iTunes, the Google Play Store, the Amazon App Store, and again, it is free. All you have to do is search for Talk Music Talk. After you subscribe, please leave a rating and or review in the store because it helps spread the word about the podcast. And now for today's episode. Hello there and welcome to episode number 91 of Talk Music Talk with Boyce. I am Boyce and this is my podcast. Thank you so much for checking it out. Talk Music Talk is a weekly music interview podcast where I have long-form discussions with people who are connected to music in some way from all different backgrounds and genres, not just musicians, but people who are working as music photographers and music therapists. And on episode number 91, I had the pleasure of speaking to Adam Goldberg. Adam is an educator. He has been teaching for over two decades, where he utilizes music as a tool to expand the world of kids with learning challenges and special needs. Since 2011, he's been using the iPad, and that was my introduction to him. I met him several months ago at an Apple Store event where he was putting on a program talking about using the iPad. He teaches at PS 177, which is in Queens. We had a great conversation. We talked about how Adam got into education, how he believes the power of music can affect changes in kids with special needs, the importance of working in ensembles, also talked about his thoughts on labeling kids, also talked about his background. Adam is a classically trained pianist and also a drummer. We talk about his own musical background. It was a pleasure to talk to someone who loves what they do and enjoys helping others in the process. This absolutely comes through in the conversation. You will enjoy it. By the way, this happened to be recorded in an air-conditioned room, so you will hear some lovely ambient air conditioning sounds. Does not take away from a great conversation. And if you enjoy episode 91, think of it in partnership with episode 92, where I interview Martina Arroyo, the opera great. Two educational episodes back to back, so check that one out also. Here it is, without further ado, my conversation with Adam Goldberg. Enjoy. I finally found out after hearing it for years the term classically trained, right? Because you're a classically trained pianist, right?
Yeah.
I finally found out what that term means. It's one of those things you hear over and over. So what was classically trained for you?
Gee, well, that's a good question because, I mean, it's almost like, I mean, and I'm going to answer maybe different than other people who are classically trained. Of course, actually, coming in from the very beginning, my motivation was different. I was not necessarily looking to be a classical musician, mm-hmm. although I went very far in that direction because I just got into the challenge of playing classical music, classical piano. But I, you know, I mean, classical music refers, it's such a broad term, but it refers to music that's composed kind of in a historical perspective, mm-hmm. from, you know, going back to Baroque music and even previous to that. That then back, then forward to Rococo and classical and impressionistic, and you know, I'm probably missing a few, but it's a very you know, if I were going to have to talk about what it is right now, I would have to say it's more or less a very regimented kind of top down approach, especially when you're playing in larger groups. I mean, you think of the orchestra there, with the conductor oftentimes being kind of the end all and be all for decisions, musical decisions. And I always kind of was going against that because I'm also coming from a place of jazz and wanting to write music myself. but not necessarily classical music.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I was told a lot, well, you have to have a classical background. I kind of wish I could do it again because I never had an interest in being a classical musician, okay. like I said. So I probably would have gone about my, yeah. my musical background differently. I'm not unhappy that I, you know, learned so much about playing those really big classical yeah. pieces, but I probably didn't have to go that far into it. And, you know, it kept me away from learning a lot of the jazz and pop or rock and other genres mm-hmm. that I wanted to, and, you know, discovering world music and discovering electronic music.
Yeah.
You know, which I would have been more free to do if I didn't have to spend, you know, 6 or maybe even 8 hours a day in a practice room, you know.
Yeah. How old were you when you started?
I think I first started lessons when I was 8 or 9.
Okay.
Maybe 9.
Okay. So for you, it's classically trained or specific composer or specific like period, or is it just like a broad?
Yeah, it was all of that kind of broad stuff, especially once I got into college as a classical piano major.
Okay.
You know, it had to be broad, and I started to hear about composers that mm-hmm. I never heard about before and so on, and really learn about the different periods of, you know, quote unquote classical music.
Mm-hmm.
Alongside of classical music has always been every other kind of music.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's just that has kind of become, you know, the dominant, accepted, legitimate, quote unquote, mm-hmm. kind of music. And, you know, I kind of reject that also.
Okay. You know? Did you choose to play piano, or was that like a family decision?
Oh, yeah. That was, my mom was a big antique fan. So one day an antique piano found its way into our house. This really big upright piano somehow came into the house. And, you know, it was not in playing condition at all, but I would just go over, you know, as a 5-year-old or so, just go over and just play. And my mother thought that whatever I did, of course, uh-huh. as a mother, she thought that whatever I did was fantastic. So, but I was interested. So when she said, oh, would you want to take lessons?
Okay.
I said, yes.
Okay. And where were you? Where are you from?
South Orange, New Jersey.
Okay. South Orange?
Not too far away. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I haven't been back there in a long time. We sold our house right before I went to college. And
God. Did you enjoy the whole process of learning, like, as a kid? Or does that keep you away from doing other things, like playing and all
no,
that?
No, I was, I was pretty active into sports and just kind of running around and mm-hmm. doing lots of stuff. The piano was always a part of that, and it wasn't until I really decided, you know, that I was probably going to music school that yeah. I really started to practice a lot and, you know, tell my friends who called and wanted to go and do stuff, now uh-huh. I gotta practice, you know. So it was more or less my own decision
okay.
to when that happened, but not until, you know, into my, you know, late mid-teens, you know,
okay.
16, 17 at least.
Mm-hmm. Did you have were you thinking like a music career or teaching
yeah.
at the time, or you weren't sure?
Definitely not teaching. That came later also, mm-hmm. but, you know, wasn't sure exactly, but I knew that I wanted to play the piano and be a performer
mm-hmm.
At the time. And, you know, again, maybe like in a jazz
okay.
vein.
And how did the jazz rear its head? Like, how'd you get into jazz?
Jazz? It kind of bebopped. It didn't
okay.
rear. It kind of bebopped back and forth. That was something, actually. Well, I also played the drums.
Okay.
So the first music that I heard that was like the music that I kind of had in my head was a Chick Corea album,
mm-hmm.
Return of the Seventh Galaxy.
Okay.
And so I bought it and I took it home and I actually started playing drums to it.
Mm-hmm.
And so Lenny White, great
yeah,
drummer.
Yeah, yeah.
So I learned what he was doing with this music that I thought was incredible. So that's what kind of got me in that direction. And I guess not too long after that, I discovered WRVR, a radio station
okay.
that played all jazz. So I just, you know, started learning a lot about all the different
mm-hmm.
jazz groups and players and artists. that were around. And that was just the music that I loved to listen to the most. And I wasn't really, you know, having the classical background.
Yeah.
I didn't really know what to do with my ear.
Okay.
You know, to just say, okay, I love this sound. So now I'm going to sit down and I'm going to start, you know, figuring it out. So, and that also didn't happen until when I was in college, and on the side I started taking some jazz piano lessons.
Okay.
And it was almost more in the beginning, more like jazz theory that kind of helped me open my ears, because I learned about different jazz voicings for chords and different scales, you know, jazz scales that go along with those chords and so on. So it wasn't until then that I started to really try to play a little bit of jazz.
Okay.
But the interest started pretty early.
Okay.
13, 14 years old or so.
So is it more like drums was for jazz and piano was for classical verse?
Yeah, I didn't consciously think of it that way, but that's how it worked out. And interestingly enough, you know, I wasn't studying classical percussion, you know. I was studying drums that kind of was leading or morphing into drum set, you know, which is more going towards pop and rock and jazz and more modern and open-ended kind of stuff.
And how did, once you were getting into the jazz and playing that, how did that change your playing or affect your playing of classical music or playing in general?
Classical music probably, especially at that time, probably not much at all, because, I mean, it was just, you know, this is the music, it's written out, and this is what you play, and there were certain little kind of parameters within which you could interpret. You know, I didn't, I did try to start playing a little more by ear, but, you know, just kind of basic stuff.
Were you
doing... I guess I always did that, though, even before I got interested in jazz. You know, because again, the classical piano came as a result of me writing some music.
Okay.
And I took it to someone and they kind of said it was good, but they also said, well, you know, you should study classical. There we go again. as if there weren't people like Duke Ellington and these incredible Gershwin and incredible, you know, jazz composers. So, you know, it was suggested for me to study classical, and that's where I, you know, got into the challenge of playing classical piano. So I, in a sense, to be honest, I kind of lost track of what I was doing because of the challenge of just playing, you know. And I was game for the challenge, you know, but I did kind of let that sidetrack me a bit, and I really didn't really compose much at all, even in college and beyond college, just a little bit.
Yeah. Where'd you go to college?
Manhattan School of Music.
Okay. And you went for music theory or?
No, classical piano.
Classical, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And were you performing like out during college, like bands or any type of sessions or anything like that?
Pretty much not. Very rarely I would get a call for a gig. Before I was officially done with all of my requirements to graduate as a classical piano major, I was asked to tour with the Glenn Miller Orchestra, which had a, you know, kind of a postpartum iteration that was, I think, put into Glenn Miller's will, so, and funded that way.
Yeah.
So that, I don't know if they still do it. I don't think so.
Yeah.
But they toured the country, and I was a part of that for a few months, not too long.
Okay, how was that? What was that like?
It was fun. It was a blast. But it was kind of weird also, because there were a lot of nights where you would sleep in the bus, because you'd have to travel really far, and there was no time to stop overnight to stay in a hotel. But it was fun.
Yeah, how'd you find out about that? You had to audition?
Actually, it was a gig that I was playing at with someone who was formerly in the band, and I guess they were looking for a piano player, and the guy who I was playing with, I guess, said, okay, maybe check this guy out. So
you're playing Glenn Miller classics, stuff that he made popular.
yes. Very kind of, you know, 40s-ish society-type jazz, I guess.
Okay.
If you'd call it that.
Okay.
I mean, but there were a lot of fun, interesting things in the book, too, other than what you might think of as the typical Glenn Miller repertoire.
What did you enjoy playing most?
Back in terms of
with that those, music, with Glenn Miller, those, the Glenn Miller days.
To be honest, I don't remember the songs. You know, although what I can say is that every once in a while, there, you know, we would have time to stop off somewhere, and you know, maybe there was a bar or a club, and mm-hmm. we could go. Some of the guys in the band would go and jam.
Yeah,
know? And so that was the most fun because these were really good players. You know, and. You know, there were a lot of other types of jazz that we all love to play. So that was when we could all kind of stretch out, throw the Glenn Miller charts away and play stuff with that we were more interested in.
So. Got it. So what happens after you graduate from school? Or you know what you're going to do? Or when the Glenn Miller, was that during school or right after?
That was kind of near the end. Okay. Of, I was basically done, but I had a few other requirements to fulfill, like a concerto that you have to perform a concerto.
Okay.
So that took a year or two after that.
Yeah.
So I graduated like way after I should have.
Okay.
Because of the Glenn Miller Orchestra and some of my other interests of playing jazz and stuff that did start to happen at that time.
And where are you looking to go musically after you finish school?
Yeah, to play jazz and you know, or you know, other types of music too. You know, I just wanted to be a very versatile musician so that I could, you know, play in a wide variety of musical situations. But it's hard to do that.
Yeah.
And there's tons of competition. And, you know, I was, again, kind of going back to what I said earlier, I was hampered by the whole classical thing. Because while other people were playing all kinds of jazz and learning a ton of stuff, I was still, you know, trying to learn all the classical pieces that my teacher wanted me to play. And every year you had a jury, you know, and then, you know, again, the requirements to graduate, which I was behind on, so there was always kind of that pull in my heart away from the classical, but in the practical head, you know, away from the other kinds of music to just finish playing the classical so that I would finish my degree.
How did the teaching come about? When did that come about?
So, you know, as a person who was trying to make it as a musician and, you know, I mean, doing okay for myself or by myself, just supporting myself. I was doing, you know, okay. I did, you know, I was young and I didn't really have many needs or many standards for how I wanted to live, but I was eating every day and I could pay my rent and that was good.
Yeah.
But, you know, I met my wife at the time, and you know, when it was time to think about getting married, you know, it was also time to think about having much more financial stability. So, you know, it was really more or less just suggested, well, you know, what about teaching? And I always had in my head, because I loved learning and I loved studying and I also loved sharing. So, you know, every once in a while I would kind of visualize myself kind of imparting to a class, I guess, you know, what I was learning and explaining music in a way that made sense to me after kind of in retrospect and more of a way that kind of just made sense of it and didn't kind of pedanticize it too much. So, But it wasn't a serious thought. It was just like a, you know, like, okay, when I'm gigging as much as I want, I can also teach on the side or whatever, which it wound up, of course, being much more the opposite of that.
And in your visualization, the kids are how are they? How are they responding in your visualization?
Oh, of course, they're totally. You know, you have no clue, so they're of course totally compliant. They're taking notes, or they're writing stuff down, or they're answering super intelligent questions. You know,
and that matches up with the first year.
Yeah, exactly. when kids are running around and you just have no idea, you're just totally overwhelmed.
How do you find your groove Like your first year of teaching?
Well, I did have it easy because I was able to teach music pretty much right away.
Mm-hmm.
There were two experiences because it was substitute teaching
okay.
at the time. So I was substituting in two places primarily. One was like it was a high school.
Yeah.
And I would go and just kind of play musical examples and talk about it, you know. I thought that was working out
yeah.
okay, but I also was, well, actually, they did offer me a job, but I was also working at the school I'm teaching at now,
okay.
P177Q.
Okay.
I was called into sub, and this was like a totally different world. There were 30 to 40 kids
mm-hmm.
sitting, some of them with mean looks on their face, some of them bigger than me, you know. And, you know, I'm hoping that what I'm saying is going to at least
yeah.
hold their attention for the 45 minutes. And then this other environment at P177 where 6 or 8 students, at the very most 12,
okay.
to a room. There's other adults in the room. And yes, these students are challenged. At the time, we also had a lot of very behaviorally challenged
mm-hmm.
students, not so much anymore, or if so, they're challenged behaviorally in a different way and for different reasons. But we had, when I first started working, even as a sub at P177Q,
yeah.
we had some very street smart kids.
Yeah.
So, but again, I think because I came in with music, they were a little more willing to
yeah.
to at least give me an inch, and
as
you
opposed
know,
to math.
Yeah, and when I would give them little instruments to play, I think that was very helpful for them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that could really hold their interest and get them to have something to focus
yeah.
on.
Yeah. Were you just teaching basic theory to them, or
no? I just decided that the best thing to do with them, which was really what I wanted to do anyway,
yeah.
was just let them have a hands-on kind of ears-on,
yeah.
real authentic music making experience.
Mm-hmm.
So, and at the time, it was so much different than what it evolved into. But you know, I mean, there were instruments that we could call them ORF instruments, so
mm-hmm.
they were basically mallet instruments
okay.
like vibraphone, xylophone, you know,
mm-hmm.
and other types of percussion and keyboards. So with some of those, you know, behaviorally challenged
mm-hmm.
kids who were, many of whom were close or on grade level,
okay.
I mean, we could get into, you know, I could teach them some stuff.
Yeah.
Even if they didn't know music before, I could teach them a few chords and teach them how to play some melodies and rhythms on percussion,
mm-hmm.
Different mallet instruments and so on. So
okay. So what would look like a successful student to you, like after they finished your class for the year? Like okay, I reached that goal. Or did you have like an intention?
It has always been about playing in an ensemble, and me finding the way to best challenge the student without, you know, like overwhelming
mm-hmm.
them, so that they stayed interested and felt like, okay, I can do this,
yeah.
But I still have to kind of work on it a little bit, you know. And if they got it too early, maybe
yeah.
I would add something, you know. And you can present that in positive ways, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So. As long as they would, they meaning like the class, each class that I went to, even back then and even more so now, I would kind of consider like an ensemble. Okay,
okay.
This is our ensemble, and we're going to learn to play whatever. One song was usually more than enough,
yeah.
but if they could learn more than one song, we would do that. And the culmination would be a performance, you know, in a like school-wide
mm-hmm.
show for the rest of their peers and the teachers and other staff.
Yeah.
So as long as they all could do that relatively
yeah.
successfully, then they all achieved the goal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, no big
yeah.
fancy, no Rachmaninoff concertos, and you know, just. You know, and you know, sure, this was an experience for them, probably something unique.
Yeah.
So,
what is it you like about the ensemble element?
As you know, especially as a jazz player, that's where I'm coming from.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost all of the music and the way I would listen and over the years learn to listen to music was to kind of really be able to tune into each part individually and you know, hear and perceive how it all fits together.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's pretty much,
yeah.
For the most part, that's just how pretty much everyone plays music, unless they're a soloist or unless they're just part of a big orchestra, and that's they're always just in that their section as a violin section, horn section, whatever. And of course, those people usually do other stuff too that are smaller scale but ensemble oriented. So I think that's pretty. I mean, I think that's the whole. The whole idea on even a very simple level of, that's kind of the social aspect of it.
Okay.
To a very deep level of, this is the unity we're talking about.
Okay.
Go on stage and here it is in front of you in this kind of musical microcosm. And this is, I'm getting into that more and more with my student band, the P177Q Technology Band. Just getting them to understand that this is the best we can do to represent what we're striving for as a democracy.
Okay.
I guess I never really was able to perceive it or voice it or describe it that way until fairly recently, the last year or two. But even back then, that was in my mind. Especially since the students had so many challenges and even especially social challenges that, I thought it was a lot that they could accomplish if they could all play music, even if it's just one song, they could all play it together and, decide that they're all going to listen to each other and stick to the beat and stick to their own parts and accept the fact that one person's part seems to maybe be more fun or cool or important.
Yeah.
And, that was a big thing early on, especially at emphasizing the point that everyone's part is just as important because if you're missing one, it just doesn't sound right anymore,
So were they all these because they were autistic or on the spectrum?
The students that I was referring to with behavioral challenges were not necessarily autistic, but our school has always had about 50% or so of our student body is on the spectrum.
Okay.
And it's very, it's a little bit tricky, without getting too political about it. It's kind of easy to kind of check off that box that says autism if you're not sure what else it might be.
Okay.
Or if there's a few things you see, but, in combination, well, maybe they kind of might look like autism. Mm-hmm. And then there's some parents who might say, okay, that's okay because it might be easier to get funding or other supports, educational supports if you show the student is on the spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
I guess the reason why I bring that up is just to say that, it's really not about the label.
Yeah.
The label may be accurate or not.
Mm-hmm.
And especially, I guess, I'm lucky that as a music person, I can see past that because of the music. And because music is so empowering to so many people, regardless of their background or ability or disability, quote unquote. I don't even like to use that word.
Yeah.
It's just a varying degree of abilities and expressions of those abilities.
Yeah.
So, and music is something that I think people who may not feel that they're able to express themselves, maybe because they have verbal challenges, yeah. maybe because they're not good at writing or reading or arithmetic or other academic areas, that music is that one place where all those kind of constraints yeah. are gone, and it really is a mode of expression. And I think so many of, I can tell by the way so many of my nonverbal students mm-hmm. listen to music, that they're really listening.
Yeah.
You know, they're listening to the music uh-huh. a lot more than they listen to me when I'm using my words. Uh-huh. You know, music, in a sense, to me, goes so far beyond our, you know, kind of limited, constrained mm-hmm. vocabulary. You know,
yeah.
I mean, you could speak 10 different languages, but even if you figured out a way to combine them mm-hmm. all, I don't think it's really going to equate to what one piece of music can draw
yeah.
from a person, you know, emotionally, and even in a kind of deeper sense that I don't think we're ready to kind of acknowledge or measure yet, but mm-hmm. even in an intellectual sense.
Yeah.
I mean, even, you know, they say music, you know, listening, well, I talked about like listening to the different parts and you know, it's almost like a geometry of the okay. mind, you know, or, you know, an architecture
mm-hmm.
That's coming in through your ears and seeping into your head and into your intellect
yeah.
as well as hopefully into your heart and mm-hmm. soul, you know, so it's just this incredibly
yeah.
powerful thing, you know, and I'm just really, you know, so grateful to be able to share that, you know, and I you know, as a, again, going back to my days and, you know, even studying music or even playing as a performer in the early days, it was just, you know, oh, you know, music is so cool. I love music. Oh, look, check out those changes.
Yeah.
Or check out those, you know, chords and the way he's improvising over it. That's awesome. And yeah, it is awesome, but there's such a deeper level mm. to all of that I've kind of finally been able to discover through teaching, you know, and kind of getting away from the, you know, the deeply technical and theoretical mm-hmm. stuff that, you know, a lot of musicians, I think rightfully so, need to get into at
yeah.
least for a while. You know, there's something so far beyond that
mm-hmm.
that's the really true root of what this incredible,
yeah.
incredibly powerful thing.
So was it you discovered that as you were teaching these kids, or did you have an inkling of that beforehand
yeah.
with these?
Of the tiniest inkling
mm-hmm.
beforehand, but as I think I grew as a person and as an educator, and, you know, importantly also as an advocate for the arts,
okay.
you know, I started to realize, well, why am I so passionate about wanting to advocate for the arts?
Yeah.
And then I just started to look deeper and unfold, you know, why do I feel this way about music
mm-hmm.
or when I'm playing music or even when my students are playing music
yeah.
and they do something and it just, wow, it hits me. It really sounds
yeah.
good, and it's not because they've practiced for years or have this incredible
uh-huh.
technique or understanding. It's just that they feel something in their own really unique way
mm-hmm.
because maybe it's coming at them for the first time, or maybe they have their own special way of bringing it out
yeah.
of themselves. And it's like, yeah.
You can't
wow.
help but feel that.
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
yeah.
So I met you at the Apple store.
Uh-huh.
And when you were doing your presentation for iPads.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah.
And using with the kids. How did that come about, using iPads? Because you went from using more traditional instruments.
Yes. So, you know, the idea of trying to use technology and being aware that it could be helpful as a support
mm-hmm.
for some of my students especially, was kind of there for a long time, but I think it was, you know, a combination of my lack of technical knowledge
mm-hmm.
and the fact that computers, it was just computers
yeah.
at the time, were very limiting, and the software you needed to use was to make music was pretty complex, and also limiting unless you spent more and more money to kind of expand it.
Okay.
So I was always discouraged and, you know, would try to delve into it and then go away from it. Then a colleague of mine mentioned GarageBand, which at the time was on the Mac. And I remember reading about it once, and I was, you know, it was just kind of in my mind that was already skewed negatively towards technology. I was like, yeah, it's just another one of these things.
Yeah.
It doesn't sound really like I'm going to be able to use it much. But when this colleague of mine sat me down in front of a computer running GarageBand, and he showed me how easy it is to drag in loops and how you could really just create these compositions just from the loops, you know, my eyes started opening, you know, in terms of, and I guess when I was first reading that article, I was kind of reading it from my musician's point of view, but then later on as an educator, I'm thinking, you know, and working with the students and realizing some of the things that they might need or what might be helpful.
Mm-hmm.
I saw this as really something, certainly at least to check out, and sure enough, you know, I had a few students right off the bat that were very successful in creating their own little compositions just by using the loops in GarageBand.
Yeah.
So because of that success, I wanted to expand, and I was looking around just to expand and buy more loops.
Yeah.
At the time, I think they called them loop packs for GarageBand. So I came across this one advertisement that said free loop packs.
Yeah.
What it turned out to be was that if you bought Logic, at the time I think it was called Logic Studio, if you bought Logic Studio, you would get all of those jam packs for free, along with it was just part of the package. So I went ahead and did that. I believe I got the funds from my school to do that. And knowing that that program was coming soon and that it was a lot more complicated than GarageBand, although truth is GarageBand is modeled off of Logic.
Yeah.
It's like the simplified version of Logic. So when you learn GarageBand, you're also learning a lot more than you might think about how to use Logic.
Okay.
And since then, Apple has even made it even more direct. The relationship between the two is even more direct now. So you could learn GarageBand and find it much easier to convert to Logic.
Okay.
So, but even back in that, at that time, you know, I started to look at some instructional videos that taught a lot of things about how to use Logic. And it was like, everything that I saw was like, wow, if I started doing with this with my students, this would be really awesome. And so it was. I needed to get some accompanying devices like hardware controllers, control surfaces, MIDI controllers, what have you. They're called a few different things. But with just a few of those and some of the MIDI keyboards that I already had, all of a sudden my little ensembles started to sound like full orchestras or full bands because of the power within Logic Studio at the time, and especially using the environment to manipulate MIDI, incoming MIDI, to, you know, expand it and send it to different channels and different types of software instruments. So, I mean, boy, that was really a blast for me. And for the biggest reason was that I could see my students and the joy that they had just from being able to just press a few keys or trigger a few pads on a controller. And, you know, hear these incredible sounds. Yeah. And they were just so into it. And they, meaning, you know, there was always a small segment of the student population that I could do pretty significant things with. But now, all of a sudden, that expanded greatly. So I was going along, and I was just really a happy camper using Logic and just getting into working out all of these environment kind of setups. But then, lo and behold, along comes the iPad. Yeah. And it's certainly worth mentioning MacProVideo.com, I guess, if that's okay. That's where I was getting these instructional videos for learning Logic from. But they also had a hub, like a free online like instructional articles section, instructional articles, reviews, so on and so forth. So when the iPad came out, the guy who was like the editor of the hub at the time, he put up these like mock photos of the iPad running different kinds of music software. And I was looking at that, and you weren't really sure what it was doing because it was just a mock photo of like concepts. But it was like, yeah, wow, that must be real. Whatever it is, that must be really awesome. And so sure enough, when the iPad did come out, you know, I started to check out a few things that were just awesome after more awesome about what the iPad could do. And I guess the fall after the iPad first came out, there was a grant run by my district, and I applied for the grant, and the grant was just the application was just kind of like showing all these different apps, and at the time it was relatively a very few.
Yeah,
but there were still a lot of them even then, or in the very early days, that were really incredible.
Yeah.
And so that was my proposal, was to show all of these different apps and what they could do and how I could use them with my students. And most importantly, how even back then, there were a bunch of apps that could be modified so that they could be, you know, just easier to play.
Okay.
So, you know, it was, I got a grant and from that time on, it's just been just like a no-brainer to just use iPads a lot. I'm still using Logic, and now there's control surface apps on the iPad that are, you know, they're not pieces of hardware where if you have 12 buttons, that's it. You got 12 buttons and they stay where they are. Now, if you only need one button, you put that one button exactly where you want, and then you put a few pads if you need those and a few other triggers, and everything can be fully customized. Okay. So it makes it perfect for me to meet the needs, like I mentioned before, meet the needs of each student, so I could challenge each student appropriately to what they can handle. And of course, in addition to the control surface apps, there are so many other apps that, you know, are professional quality in sound and design. And yet at the same time, even though they're made for professional use, they can be modified again so that it's much easier to play and my students can get a good grasp. I mean, I can just have them play a certain part. I can designate a certain scale or certain scale degrees. Those are the only choices that the student has, and so they know they're not going to hit a wrong note.
Okay.
They feel more confident. They're happy, and yet again, I can still challenge them, musically speaking, to play certain rhythms accurately, or, you know, to play a certain combination of notes, and of course to keep it all within that all important ensemble. That was the journey, I guess, in terms of, you know, adapting the technology and how, you know, I mean, I made a big deal about, you know, how Logic, me using Logic and some of those control surfaces as that was such a boon, but even more so with the iPad. And then there's these other aspects that play into it besides the customizability. The fact that it's so personal for each student, and, you know, the visual aspects and some of the apps are very purposeful about combining the visual with the auditory or the music output. And, of course, that's something that the students really, really love. A lot of our students that have challenges, even though it seems to be counterintuitive, you want to just kind of think, okay, let's just do one step at a time with this student. Well, no, actually, a lot of them do much better when there's a multisensory approach. So they see it, they hear it, they feel it, and then they're more likely to grab on to one of those sensory inputs and make sense of it. Or maybe they need more information to make sense of it, you know, and they're better at combining those things than we would think. It's also something, you know, when I say the word they, that's really also not really, it's a habit, but it's not really the best way to describe people who are just as individualistic as any other person. They're not, okay, these are the autistic ones, these are the ones with other learning disabilities. It doesn't work like that. They're all individuals. They all have personalities. They all have their own individual preferences and rights. So
like anybody else, right?
Exactly. And so, you know, to assume, well, one person who has the same kind of learning challenge is gonna have the same needs as the other person who does, that's it just doesn't work that way. And maybe especially because of, especially in terms of music, you know, and that's where my experience is. I mean, if I wanted to speak about how to teach students how to do math, I you know, I wouldn't be able to talk about it. But in terms of music, certainly, you know, recognizing the individual and evaluating and respecting and providing, musically speaking, for that student as an individual is that's the key. And if you start, if you approach it that way from the outset, then you start to see the individual that way, and you start to be able to recognize where the abilities are and where the needs are and where you can challenge that student. And yes, that going back to the technology, and especially with the iPad, because there's so many apps out there and so many different ways to customize and so many kind of different ways to enter those sensory inputs for each student, well, that's, I guess, the best thing is that there are all these tools. And in a sense, that the biggest challenge is just finding the right tool. And it's not hard to do, but once you do that, you can tell right away, pretty much, you know, or at least you know you're in the right ballpark. And then you say, okay, let's work with this app now. You seem to enjoy this app, and you know, then they're more comfortable with that, because they do. You can, again, just from observing, you can see, okay, there is more focus now when the student is using this app, or they're more likely to be able to execute this rhythm or this, you know, melodic pattern or harmonic.
Have they studied why, or is it the tactile and the visual combination? Like, do they know specifically? Is it known why they respond to these apps with the music on the iPad? Specifically these kids are responding to what's going on the iPad?
I guess the short answer, it would have to be no. There's a lot of research, and that's where, you know, I actually wanted to do some research this year. But it's really a very emerging kind of field. The iPads still have, they still haven't been in education that long. There are really still only pockets of places where they're used fairly widely, but very successfully. And, you know, I mean, there was just one, well, you know, there was one story where it basically, what it is if you don't train the educators first and prepare and think out your implementation, then you're more prone to having it not be successful. You know, but with the proper planning and you know, forethought and teacher and administrator training, then you can have incredibly successful programs. But sure, why? I mean, I can kind of talk to why without trying to pass myself off as a researcher or an expert, but just from my own
From your
observations,
own
experience, yeah. I kind of touched on it already with the multi-sensory and the fact that there's so many different apps that can be modified. Even a simple thing like, iMovie, for example, and asking a student to show what they know about something that has either has been taught or just something that they already know. And you can show that by using iMovie. And in iMovie, you can import pictures. You can make a movie of something or someone or even yourself. You can do a voiceover. You can add text. Or you can, if you like to write, you can maybe not use iMovie and use, a word processing app like Pages. But there are so many different ways to express your learning. And it's, again, it's not just for one person. Like I said, well, one person might like to write, but another person might like to speak about what they know. Another person might like to show you in pictures or in film, and you might find out that wow, this person has incredible potential and or ability as a future filmmaker, possibly. So that's one of the reasons is because it offers the student so many more options to express themselves, and also receive the learning, because we all can express ourselves in different mediums, in different ways. Well, we learn differently also, and some people need a few of those ways coming in. We need to see it. We need to hear it. We need to write it or read it, I should say, and then also maybe write it. And for some people, maybe more of those ways are better, or maybe only one way is better. And so it's not just iMovie. There's so many other apps that allow you a variety of options for, both receiving and expressing the learning. So that's a huge part of it, and of course, kind of the cool factor is not gone yet. And I don't think I guess there'll be a time that it might be completely gone when there's other things that are even more cool. But as of now, it's still, pretty much the coolest thing. So that especially for kids who want to be cool and want to be, that's always a good thing. And of course, you can teach them a lot about responsibility for handling these devices that are expensive and sophisticated, that's important too. But sure, just from my experiential point of view, there's a lot of reasons. It's certainly, we've just come such a long, long way from the chalkboard or the pencil and paper or the book on the desk. And all of that is fine. It's not that we should never, ever use any of that anymore. There are times and places for all of that, but it's just as wrong to exclude those as it is to exclude the new technologies, especially for our youth, who are all digital natives, and that's another reason why they're going to take to all of that, because it's just, that's what they're comfortable with.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
So is there anywhere online people can read about or find out more?
Well, I mentioned macprovideo.com. Okay. So there's an author page. I haven't written any articles for them in a while. But there's a bunch of articles, about a lot of these apps that I'm using and how I use them.
I'll put that in the show notes.
And there's I really, surprisingly, even though I just love to talk about my band, the student band that I have, the P177Q technology band. If you're looking online, you can also look under PS177Q technology band. But we have a page on Vimeo. There's a few things out there on YouTube. there was also a wonderful series of reports that NPR or features that, mm-hmm. that NPR radio did on All Things Considered and Morning Edition. So you could, if you look under, I guess you could search for PS177 okay. Technology Band on NPR, or yes, I can provide you the link, links to those. Thinking if there's anything else. Yes, I have an iTunes U course.
Okay.
iPad as Expressive Sound Canvas, mm-hmm. Which is, that's a free, if as long as you have the iTunes U app, which is free,
yeah.
you can download any iTunes U course mm-hmm. for free. And that was a really amazing journey about combining like abstract expressionist art with free jazz improvisation. So, and it's a course. It's so it's something that you could share with almost any level of student. And it's great for immersing the student in, mm-hmm. in learning about those art forms and how, you know, the similarities and how to improvise freely in jazz or create an abstract expressionist uh-huh. work of art, you know. Which is a lot of fun, as even though I'm not an art teacher, you know, letting students splatter paint uh-huh. on a big canvas,
I guess is
a fun thing for the kids to do, given, you know, certain parameters uh-huh. that you would want to set in place, of course.
great. Well, thank you, Adam. This is wonderful.
Okay, yes. Cool. You're very, very welcome, Boyce.
Sure, sure.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're welcome. I really admire what you're doing, and I wish the best.
Okay, thank you.
And there you have it, my conversation with Adam Goldberg on Talk Music Talk. I hope you enjoyed it. And as I mentioned, I will put all of the links that he talked about in the show notes. As for me, you can find me several places, several ways online, talkmusictalk.com, where you can find out more info on the podcast. This is voice.com. I am a singer. I'm a songwriter, also a novelist. So you can check out my books and music there. And if you are on Instagram, follow me at This Is Boyce. And don't forget about the app. Download it, Talk Music Talk, for iPhone and Android, wherever you get your apps. And when you download it, you will get episode number 92, which is in tandem with this episode for a pair of educational TMT episodes with opera great Martina Arroyo talking about her foundation. Till next time, and there will be a next time. This one's for you, Liz.